Recorded Books Incorporated presents an unabridged recording of The Rough Riders by Theodore Roosevelt, narrated by John Randolph Jones. This work, first published in 1899, was written less than a year after the events which it describes. This recording is copyrighted 1993 by Recorded Books Incorporated. Theodore Roosevelt was born in New York City on October 27, 1858, into a country and family in conflict. His father, of an old Dutch family that had long been active in city affairs, was devoted to the Northern cause. His mother, of Scotch-Irish and Huguenot descent, supported the South, where her family had engaged in distinguished service. The future 26th president's commitment to national solidarity and his belief in military preparedness had origins in this familial and civil discord. He was frail and sickly as a youth, necessitating tutors and little companionship with other boys. Only with great deliberation did he persist in building up his strength, and he remained always concerned with health and vitality. He entered Harvard in 1876. His scholarship was good but not exceptional. He learned more from his hunting trips to Maine, where he became attracted to the vigorous life of the outdoors and the simplicity, courage, and endurance of the backwoodsman. The Ivy League city boy wanted to win their respect, to be treated by them as an equal, and he succeeded. It was this ability to bridge differences in class and education, in urban, rural, and diverse regional backgrounds, that enabled Theodore Roosevelt to raise the Rough Riders and forge them into a cohesive fighting unit, and as president, prevent America from experiencing the kind of violent social upheavals the Industrial Revolution brought about in continental Europe. In 1881, Roosevelt joined a political club and won election to the New York State Assembly, where he quickly brought public attention to himself and the contempt of politicos by trying to impeach a corrupt judge. In later life, he acknowledged that the next 3 years of political fighting taught him that power lies in the subordination of the individual to the team, a philosophy he successfully brought with him to the Rough Riders, though he always remained a stalwart individualist. As chairman of the New York delegation to the Chicago Republican Convention in 1884, he supported a candidate who lost. Roosevelt then declared that the winner deserved the support of all loyal Republicans. The losers saw this as political treason, and the victors regarded him with suspicion. For the time, his political career was over. Roosevelt's wife died in early 1884, following the birth of a daughter. His mother died 12 hours later. Low in spirits, he took off to his ranch in western Dakota. There he befriended cowboys and sheriffs and an idiosyncratic array of frontiersmen. He shared in their hardships and pleasures, and they admired his wide knowledge, courage, and forthrightness. Within a short time, he was a leader of law enforcement in the region, instrumental in checking the activities of cattle thieves. In 1886, he was called back to run as mayor of New York, a race which he lost. President Harrison appointed him to the U.S. Civil Service Commission, where he fought the spoils system and advocated meritocracy over patronage. In 1895, he became president of the Police Board of New York City, where he tried to rid the force of bribery and corruption, though his efforts were opposed by both parties and the newspapers. During these years, he was making an impression on Americans throughout the country, a reputation he would further build upon with the publication of his book, The Rough Riders. When McKinley was elected president, Roosevelt was appointed Assistant Secretary of the Navy. He reorganized the fleet and brought it to a high state of preparedness, for he believed there would be, and should be, a war against Spain, a war to liberate colonial peoples who were arguably the most oppressed remaining in the Western Hemisphere. Cuban insurgents already had the sympathy of the American public, roused by continuous reports of atrocities in the yellow press. On February 15, 1898, the United States battleship Maine blew up in Havana Harbor, killing 266 men. The official inquiry, completed on March 21st, showed it to have been caused by a mine attached to the hull of the ship. On the 24th, the Spanish government declared war. On the 25th, Congress responded in kind. Roosevelt resigned his post as Assistant Secretary of the Navy to form the first all-volunteer cavalry regiment with high hopes of action in what Secretary of State John Milton Hay called a splendid little war. And now, the Rough Riders.
Chapter 1. Raising the Regiment. During the year preceding the outbreak of the Spanish War, I was Assistant Secretary of the Navy. While my party was in opposition, I had preached with all the fervor and zeal I possessed our duty to intervene in Cuba and to take this opportunity of driving the Spaniard from the Western world. Now that my party had come to power, I felt it incumbent on me, by word and deed, to do all I could to secure the carrying out of the policy in which I so heartily believed. And from the beginning I had determined that, if a war came, somehow or other, I was going to the front. Meanwhile, there was any amount of work at hand in getting ready the Navy, and to this I devoted myself. Naturally, when one is intensely interested in a certain cause, the tendency is to associate particularly with those who take the same view. A large number of my friends felt very differently from the way I felt, and looked upon the possibility of war with sincere horror. But I found plenty of sympathizers, especially in the Navy, the Army, and the Senate Committee on Foreign Affairs. Commodore Dewey, Captain Evans, Captain Brownson, Captain Davis, with these and the various other naval officers on duty at Washington, I used to hold long consultations, during which we went over and over not only every question of naval administration, but specifically everything necessary to do in order to put the Navy in trim to strike quick and hard, if, as we believed would be the case, we went to war with Spain. Sending an ample quantity of ammunition to the Asiatic squadron and providing it with coal, getting the battleships and the armored cruisers on the Atlantic into one squadron, both to train them in maneuvering together and to have them ready to sail against either the Cuban or the Spanish coasts, gathering the torpedo boats into a flotilla for practice, securing ample target exercise so conducted as to raise the standard of our marksmanship, gathering in the small ships from European and South American waters, settling on the number and kind of craft needed as auxiliary cruisers. Every one of these points was threshed over in conversations with officers who were present in Washington, or in correspondence with officers who, like Captain Mahan, were absent. As for the senators, of course, Senator Lodge and I felt precisely alike, for to fight in such a cause and with such an enemy was merely to carry out the doctrines we had both of us preached for many years. Senator Davis, Senator Proctor, Senator Foraker, Senator Chandler, Senator Morgan, Senator Fry, and a number of others also took just the right ground. And I saw a great deal of them, as well as of many members of the House, particularly those from the West, where the feeling for war was the strongest. Naval officers came and went, and senators were only in the city while the Senate was in session. But there was one friend who was steadily in Washington. This was an Army surgeon, Dr. Leonard Wood. I only met him after I entered the Navy Department, but we soon found that we had kindred tastes and kindred principles. He had served in General Miles's inconceivably harassing campaigns against the Apaches, where he had displayed such courage that he won that most coveted of distinctions, the Medal of Honor. Such extraordinary physical strength and endurance that he grew to be recognized as one of the two or three white men who could stand fatigue and hardship as well as an Apache. And such judgment that toward the close of the campaigns he was given, though a surgeon, the actual command of more than one expedition against the bands of renegade Indians. Like so many of the gallant fighters with whom it was later my good fortune to serve, He combined in a very high degree the qualities of entire manliness with entire uprightness and cleanliness of character. It was a pleasure to deal with a man of high ideals, who scorned everything mean and base, and who also possessed those robust and hardy qualities of body and mind, for the lack of which no merely negative virtue can ever atone. He was by nature a soldier of the highest type. And like most natural soldiers, he was, of course, born with a keen longing for adventure. And though an excellent doctor, what he really desired was the chance to lead men in some kind of hazard. To every possibility of such adventure, he paid quick attention. For instance, he had a great desire to get me to go with him on an expedition into the Klondike in midwinter, at the time when it was thought that a relief party would have to be sent there to help the starving miners. In the summer, he and I took long walks together through the beautiful broken country surrounding Washington. In winter, we sometimes varied these walks by kicking a football in an empty lot, or on the rare occasions when there was enough snow, by trying a couple of sets of skis or snow skates, which had been sent me from Canada. But always on our way out to and back from these walks and sport, there was one topic to which, in our talking, we returned, and that was the possible war with Spain. We both felt very strongly that such a war would be as righteous as it would be advantageous to the honor and the interests of the nation. And after the blowing up of the Maine, we felt that it was inevitable. We then at once began to try to see that we had our share in it. The president and my own chief, Secretary Long, were very firm against my going, but they said that if I was bent upon going, they would help me. Wood was the medical advisor of both the president and the Secretary of War, and could count upon their friendship. So we started with the odds in our favor. At first, we had great difficulty in knowing exactly what to try for. We could go on the staff of any one of several generals, but we much preferred to go in the line. Wood hoped he might get a commission in his native state of Massachusetts, but in Massachusetts, as in every other state, it proved there were 10 men who wanted to go to the war for every chance to go. Then we thought we might get positions as field officers under an old friend of mine, Colonel, now General, Francis V. Green of New York, the Colonel of the 71st, but again there were no vacancies. Our doubts were resolved when Congress authorized the raising of 3 cavalry regiments from among the wild riders and riflemen of the Rockies and the Great Plains. During Wood's service in the Southwest, he had commanded not only regulars and Indian scouts, but also white frontiersmen. In the Northwest, I had spent much of my time for many years either on my ranch or in long hunting trips, and had lived and worked for months together with the cowboy and the mountain hunter, faring in every way precisely as they did. Secretary Alger offered me the command of one of these regiments. If I had taken it, being entirely inexperienced in military work, I should not have known how to get it equipped most rapidly, for I should have spent valuable weeks in learning its needs, with the result that I should have missed the Santiago campaign, and I might not even have had the consolation prize of going to Puerto Rico. Fortunately, I was wise enough to tell the secretary that while I believed I could learn to command the regiment in a month, yet that it was just this very month which I could not afford to spare, and that therefore I would be quite content to go as lieutenant colonel if he would make Wood colonel. This was entirely satisfactory to both the president and secretary, and accordingly Wood and I were speedily commissioned as colonel and lieutenant colonel of the 1st United States Volunteer Cavalry. This was the official title of the regiment, but for some reason or other, the public promptly christened us the Rough Riders. At first, we fought against the use of the term, but to no purpose. And when finally the generals of division and brigade began to write informal communications about our regiment as the Rough Riders, we adopted the term ourselves. The mustering places for the regiment were appointed in New Mexico, Arizona, Oklahoma, and Indian Territory. The difficulty in organizing was not in selecting, but in rejecting men. Within a day or two after it was announced that we were to raise the regiment, we were literally deluged with applications from every quarter of the Union. Without the slightest trouble, so far as men went, we could have raised a brigade or even a division. The difficulty lay in arming, equipping, mounting, and disciplining the men we selected. Hundreds of regiments were being called into existence by the national government, and each regiment was sure to have innumerable wants to be satisfied. To a man who knew the ground, as Wood did, and who was entirely aware of our national unpreparedness, it was evident that the ordnance and quartermaster's bureaus could not meet, for some time to come, one-tenth of the demands that would be made upon them. And it was all important to get in first with our demands. Thanks to his knowledge of the situation and promptness, we immediately put in our requisitions for the articles indispensable for the equipment of the regiment. And then, by ceaseless worrying of excellent bureaucrats, who had no idea how to do things quickly or how to meet an emergency, we succeeded in getting our rifles, cartridges, revolvers, clothing, shelter tents, and horse gear just in time to enable us to go on the Santiago expedition. Some of the state troops, who were already organized as National Guards, were, of course, ready after a fashion when the war broke out. But no other regiment which had our work to do was able to do it in anything like as quick time, and therefore no other volunteer regiment saw anything like the fighting which we did. Wood thoroughly realized what the Ordnance Department failed to realize, namely, the inestimable advantage of smokeless powder. And moreover, he was bent upon our having the weapons of the regulars, for this meant that we would be brigaded with them, and it was evident that they would do the bulk of the fighting if the war were short. Accordingly, by acting with the utmost vigor and promptness, he succeeded in getting our regiment armed with the Krag-Jorgensen carbine used by the regular cavalry. It was impossible to take any of the numerous companies which were proffered to us from the various states. The only organized bodies we were at liberty to accept were those from the four territories. But owing to the fact that the number of men originally allotted to us, 780, was speedily raised to 1,000, we were given a chance to accept quite a number of eager volunteers who did not come from the territories, but who possessed precisely the same temper that distinguished our southwestern recruits, and whose presence materially benefited the regiment. We drew recruits from Harvard, Yale, Princeton, and many another college, from clubs like the Somerset of Boston and Knickerbocker of New York, and from among the men who belonged neither to club nor to college, but in whose veins the blood stirred with the same impulse which once sent the Vikings oversea. Four of the policemen who had served under me while I was president of the New York Police Board insisted on coming, two of them to die, the other two to return unhurt after honorable and dangerous service. It seemed to me that almost every friend I had in every state had some one acquaintance who was bound to go with the Rough Riders, and for whom I had to make a place. Thomas Nelson Page, General Fitzhugh Lee, Congressman O'Dell of New York, Senator Morgan. For each of these, and for many others, I eventually consented to accept some one or two recruits. Of course, only after a most rigid examination into their physical capacity, and after they had shown that they knew how to ride and shoot. I may add that in no case was I disappointed in the men thus taken. Harvard being my own college, I had such a swarm of applications from it that I could not take 1 in 10. What particularly pleased me, not only in the Harvard, but the Yale and Princeton men, and indeed in these recruits from the older states generally, was that they did not ask for commissions. With hardly an exception, they entered upon their duties as troopers, and the spirit which they held to the end, merely endeavoring to show that no work could be too hard, too disagreeable, or too dangerous for them to perform, and neither asking nor receiving any reward in the way of promotion or consideration. The Harvard contingent was practically raised by Guy Murchie of Maine. He saw all the fighting and did his duty with the utmost gallantry, and then left the service as he had entered it, a trooper, entirely satisfied to have done his duty. And no man did it better. So it was with Dudley Dean, perhaps the best quarterback who ever played on a Harvard 11. And so with Bob Wren, a quarterback whose feats rivaled those of Dean's, and who, in addition, was the champion tennis player of America, and had, on two different years, saved this championship from going to an Englishman. So it was with Yale men like Waller, the high jumper, and Garrison and Gerard, with Princeton men like Devereaux and Channing, the football players, with Larned, the tennis player, with Craig Wadsworth, the steeplechase rider, with Joe Stevens, the crack polo player, with Hamilton Fish, the ex-captain of the Columbia crew, and with scores of others whose names are quite as worthy of mention as any of those I have given. Indeed, they all sought entry into the ranks of the Rough Riders as eagerly as if it meant something widely different from hard work, rough fare, and the possibility of death. And the reason why they turned out to be such good soldiers lay largely in the fact that they were men who had thoroughly counted the cost before entering, and who went into the regiment because they believed that this offered their best chance for seeing hard and dangerous service. Mason Mitchell of New York, who had been a chief of scouts in the Riel Rebellion, traveled all the way to San Antonio to enlist, and others came there from distances as great. Some of them made appeals to me which I could not possibly resist. Woodbury Kane had been a close friend of mine at Harvard. During the 18 years that had passed since my graduation, I had seen very little of him, though being always interested in sport, I occasionally met him on the hunting field, had seen him on the deck of the Defender when she vanquished the Valkyrie, and knew the part he had played on the Navajo when, in her most important race, that otherwise unlucky yacht vanquished her opponent, the Prince of Wales, Britannia. When the war was on, Kane felt it his duty to fight for his country. He did not seek any position of distinction. All he desired was the chance to do whatever work he was put to do well, and to get to the front, and he enlisted as a trooper. When I went down to the camp at San Antonio, he was on kitchen duty, and was cooking and washing dishes for one of the New Mexican troops, and he was doing it so well that I had no further doubt as to how he would get on. My friend of many hunts and ranch partner, Robert Monroe Ferguson of Scotland, who had been on Lord Aberdeen's staff as a lieutenant but a year before, likewise could not keep out of the regiment. He too appealed to me in terms which I could not withstand, and came in like Kane to do his full duty as a trooper, and like Kane, to win his commission by the way he thus did his duty. I felt many qualms at first in allowing men of this stamp to come in, for I could not be certain that they had counted the cost, and was afraid they would find it very hard to serve, not for a few days, but for months, in the ranks, while I, their former intimate associate, was a field officer. But they insisted that they knew their minds, and the event showed that they did. We enlisted about 50 of them from Virginia, Maryland, and the northeastern states at Washington. Before allowing them to be sworn in, I gathered them together and explained that if they went in, they must be prepared not merely to fight, but to perform the weary, monotonous labor incident to the ordinary routine of a soldier's life, that they must be ready to face fever exactly as they were to face bullets, that they were to obey unquestioningly, and to do their duty as readily if called upon to garrison a fort as if sent to the front. I warned them that work that was merely irksome and disagreeable must be faced as readily as work that was dangerous, and that no complaint of any kind must be made. And I told them that they were entirely at liberty not to go, but that after they had once signed, there could then be no backing out. Not a man of them backed out. Not one of them failed to do his whole duty. These men formed but a small fraction of the whole. They went down to San Antonio, where the regiment was to gather and where Wood preceded me, while I spent a week in Washington hurrying up the different bureaus and telegraphing my various railroad friends, so as to ensure our getting the carbines, saddles, and uniforms that we needed from the various armories and storehouses. Then I went down to San Antonio myself, where I found the men from New Mexico, Arizona, and Oklahoma already gathered, while those from Indian Territory came in soon after my arrival. These were the men who made up the bulk of the regiment and gave it its peculiar character. They came from the four territories which yet remained within the boundaries of the United States. That is, from the lands that have been most recently won over to white civilization, and in which the conditions of life are nearest those that obtained on the frontier, when there still was a frontier. They were a splendid set of men, these Southwesterners, tall and sinewy, with resolute, weather-beaten faces and eyes that looked a man straight in the face without flinching. They included in their ranks men of every occupation, but the three types were those of the cowboy, the hunter, and the mining prospector. The man who wandered hither and thither, killing game for a living, and spending his life in the quest for metal wealth. In all the world, there could be no better material for soldiers than that afforded by these grim hunters of the mountains, these wild, rough riders of the plains. They were accustomed to handling wild and savage horses. They were accustomed to following the chase with the rifle, both for sport and as a means of livelihood. Varied though their occupations had been, almost all had, at one time or another, herded cattle and hunted big game. They were hardened to life in the open and to shifting for themselves under adverse circumstances. They were used, for all their lawless freedom, to the rough discipline of the roundup and the mining company. Some of them came from the small frontier towns, but most were from the wilderness, having left their lonely hunters' cabins and shifting cow camps to seek new and more stirring adventures beyond the sea. They had their natural leaders, the men who had shown they could master other men and could more than hold their own in the eager, driving life of the new settlements. The captains and lieutenants were sometimes men who had campaigned in the regular army against Apache, Ute, and Cheyenne, and who, on completing their term of service, had shown their energy by settling in the new communities and growing up to be men of mark. In other cases, they were sheriffs, marshals, deputy sheriffs, and deputy marshals, men who had fought Indians and still more often had waged relentless war upon the bands of white desperadoes. There was Bucky O'Neill of Arizona, captain of Troop A, the mayor of Prescott, a famous sheriff throughout the West for his feats of victorious warfare against the Apache, no less than against the white road agents and man-killers. His father had fought in Mars Brigade in the Civil War, and he was himself a born soldier, a born leader of men. He was a wild, reckless fellow, soft-spoken, and of dauntless courage and boundless ambition. He was staunchly loyal to his friends and cared for his men in every way. There was Captain Llewellyn of New Mexico, a good citizen, a political leader, and one of the most noted peace officers of the country. He had been shot four times in pitched fights with red marauders and white outlaws. There was Lieutenant Ballard, who had broken up the blackjack gang of ill-omened notoriety, and his captain, Curry, another New Mexican sheriff of fame. The officers from the Indian Territory had almost all served as marshals and deputy marshals, and in the Indian Territory, service as a deputy marshal meant capacity to fight stand-up battles with the gangs of outlaws. Three of our higher officers had been in the regular army. One was Major Alexander Brody from Arizona, afterward Lieutenant Colonel, who had lived for 20 years in the Territory, and had become a thorough Westerner without sinking the West Pointer, a soldier by taste as well as training, whose men worshipped him and would follow him anywhere, as they would Bucky O'Neill or any other of their favorites. Brody was running a big mining business, but when the Maine was blown up, he abandoned everything and telegraphed right and left to bid his friends get ready for the fight he saw impending. Then there was Micah Jenkins, the captain of Troop K, a gentle and courteous South Carolinian, on whom danger acted like wine. In action, he was a perfect gamecock, and he won his majority for gallantry in battle. Finally, there was Alan Capron, who was, on the whole, the best soldier in the regiment. In fact, I think he was the ideal of what an American regular army officer should be. He was the fifth in descent from father to son, who had served in the Army of the United States. And in body and mind alike, he was fitted to play his part to perfection. Tall and lithe, a remarkable boxer and walker, a first-class rider and shot with yellow hair and piercing blue eyes, he looked what he was, the archetype of the fighting man. He had under him one of the two companies from the Indian Territory. And he so soon impressed himself upon the wild spirit of his followers that he got them ahead in discipline faster than any other troop in the regiment, while at the same time taking care of their bodily wants. His ceaseless effort was so to train them, care for them, and inspire them as to bring their fighting efficiency to the highest possible pitch. He required instant obedience and tolerated not the slightest evasion of duty. But his mastery of his art was so thorough, and his performance of his own duty so rigid, that he won at once not merely their admiration, but that soldierly affection so readily given by the man in the ranks to the superior who cares for his men and leads them fearlessly in battle. All, Easterners and Westerners, Northerners and Southerners, officers and men, cowboys and college graduates, wherever they came from and whatever their social position, possessed in common the traits of hardihood and a thirst for adventure. They were, to a man, born adventurers, in the old sense of the word. The men in the ranks were mostly young, yet some were past their first youth. These had taken part in the killing of the great buffalo herds and had fought Indians when the tribes were still on the warpath. The younger ones, too, had led rough lives, and the lines in their faces told of many a hardship endured, and many a danger silently faced with grim, unconscious philosophy. Some were originally from the East, and had seen strange adventures and different kinds of life, from sailing round the Horn to mining in Alaska. Others had been born and bred in the West, and had never seen a larger town than Santa Fe, or a bigger body of water than the Pecos and Flood. Some of them went by their own name. Some had changed their names, and yet others possessed but half a name, colored by some adjective like Cherokee Bill, Happy Jack of Arizona, Smoky Moore the Bronco Buster, so named because cowboys often call vicious horses Smoky Horses, and Rattlesnake Pete, who had lived among the Mokies and taken part in the snake dances. Some were professional gamblers, and, on the other hand, no less than four were or had been Baptist or Methodist clergymen, and proved first-class fighters, too, by the way. Some were men whose lives in the past had not been free from the taint of those fierce kinds of crime into which the lawless spirits who dwell on the borderland between civilization and savagery so readily drift. A far larger number had served at different times in those bodies of armed men with which the growing civilization of the border finally puts down its savagery. There was one characteristic and distinctive contingent which could have appeared only in such a regiment as ours. From the Indian Territory there came a number of Indians, Cherokees, Chickasaws, Choctaws, and Creeks. Only a few were of pure blood. The others shaded off until they were absolutely indistinguishable from their white comrades, with whom, it may be mentioned, they all lived on terms of complete equality. Not all of the Indians were from the Indian Territory.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.